So this is the formal hello, everybody. Welcome. We are so happy to see you here. So happy to see many of you back after 2 days. And Jonny, lovely to be here with you again today.
Yep, it feels like an eternity since we spoke.
We had such a good time. That's why I said yesterday, I hope you too, dear colleagues, had a good time, because it really was great for both of us. Let me start with four very important pieces of information. Please just remember that tomorrow there will be another webinar. This time you should have already received, or you will be receiving later today, information from your own center, right? So each center will be having its own webinar tomorrow to continue the conversation that we started on Monday with all of you, right? Just remember, if you missed one of the two previous webinars, or for your colleagues who didn't have a chance to be here, all the webinars have been recorded and you will be getting the links so that you can watch them, right? Very important also to remember that all of you who registered, even if you didn't have a chance to see the live webinar, you will be getting your corresponding certificates, right? Expect to get information about this. Certificates themselves will be, we will start delivering as of September the 29th, which is a beautiful day in September. I wonder why I'm saying that. Okay, so without further ado, and no more promotion about my birthday, Jonny, in case you didn't get that, hint, hint, hint.
I'm just making a note. Okay. 29th, yeah, wonderful time of year. So, and in September, so this is our third and final webinar, just as an introduction to the digital teacher, which hopefully people have seen plenty of over the last couple of evenings, maybe with a nice tea or a cup of hot chocolate, because it's been quite chilly in certain parts, but, well, chilly, not really. But what we're looking at today, we're going to recap briefly what we've done over the last couple of days, which we think is quite good practice. So reminding people of what's been covered. I mean, we're doing it in a very boring way, but you could probably do it as a quiz or some sort of true or false game with students. But anyway, and then we're going to look at the virtuous circle of designing, delivering, and evaluating learning. And it is a virtuous circle, or as we try to make it as much of a virtuous circle as we can. So the story so far, I wonder what people can remember. Maybe they can put it in the chat. What we did yesterday, for example, or some of the resources that we've looked at, some of the activities that we've had a bit of a discussion about. If you've got ideas, then put them in the chat. But further from that, we'll just head straight in, I think, to show you we came up with a list, didn't we, Rosalía, of things that we've covered.
Exactly. And we're going to go through that list, and we're going to see. Okay, so yes, people interested in different things. Somebody's saying, for example, Marcella talking about speak and improve.
Excellent.
Wanting to start exploring that. That is a great thing to start learning about. And try again today, so, or tomorrow. All of you, I mean, I do invite you to go. This is a great, we've been having such a great time talking to you about all the different things, different tools and resources. You will find the Cambridge name behind some of those. And remember, anything that has the Cambridge or the Michigan name, you can obviously trust it 100%. And there's quality there. And we thought about you and your different contexts, etc. So you can find, I'm sure you can find something that will help you. Right. The Cambridge Latin American webpage, definitely, with lots of different ideas for different things. Continuous professional development, which is an absolute must for teachers who are serious about being ELT professionals, right? And we invited you to explore more than Zoom or Slack or Teams or Google, whatever it is that you're using. Within it, because you can find lots and lots of different things and maybe resources and possibilities that you didn't know you had with it, right? We said, usually for us, mere mortals, it's not possible to choose the platform we would like to use, but that's not a problem. What we should do is make the most of what we have. So explore, explore, explore. Then we talk about the importance of managing all sorts of things, from resources to planning to delivering everything, right, Jonny? And I know because many people have said that they found the information about the free pictures that you can start using legally. And for example, Pixabay and the ones, the visuals that we have here and that we have been using from day one are pictures that Jonny and I found precisely using Pixabay, right?
We've got a couple of comments, teachers saying they're using it now, which is great to hear.
Lovely, lovely. And then digital ecology, and Jonny, I remember, as I said, you can imagine when I talk about new things or things that I'm very excited about, Jonny goes, oh yeah, okay, sounds interesting. Tell me more about it, right? So when I told him about digital ecology months ago, he was not convinced at first, just when I said that and say, what does that mean, right? And I say, okay, fair enough. So digital ecology, and now you've become an expert on digital ecology, Jonny. So
I wouldn't say an expert. Maybe I was always an expert without knowing it. Who knows?
Exactly.
But it was when you told me about the three R's, which we've been, over the last couple of days, we've been saying less can certainly be more in terms of your planning and implementation of classes. And what was it? It was reduce.
Reuse, recycle.
And recycle, yeah. And that exactly. Doesn't have to just be you. It can be with groups of teachers as well, or parts of the kind of teaching community that you're with in your area, at your school, or on social media. So yeah.
Oh, and I think we have a very interesting photograph about that today. For number eight, we said sometimes, yes, there is technology, but maybe it's at low tech level only. That's not a problem. We are teachers. That means we are used to doing all sorts of different things, right? And inclusivity, which is so important. And it's part of also think about things like digital welfare, right? Mm-hmm. The amount of time we've been spending in front of screens, it's that nobody would have believed that was going to happen at the beginning of this year, right? Apps that you can trust. There's so many things. I quizzed Jonny not too long ago, and I said, guess how many apps were available last year? And he almost got it right?
Lucky guess.
Yeah.
But it was, so, you said 4 million, right? Was it 4 million?
You said 4 million and it was 5 million,
okay.
Right?
So, a lot.
But usually, out of all the different apps that are created, and every day there's hundreds of new apps, usually, out of 100 new apps, somewhere between 80 and 90 something percent of those apps die because they don't become popular and nobody or practically nobody uses them, right? So, and number 10 is really essential. Create support because you are not alone. You're at home, but you're not alone. There's lots of people, colleagues, etc. There's your learners. I know some of you are still preparing to go back to the classroom very soon. Some of you have already started, etc. Wherever you are, technology makes it possible for you to connect with other people. Okay, so
and just to mention, we had a comment about helping students with writing. That might have been someone who missed yesterday's webinar. Check it out. We look at writing improving that webinar, and that's a very good tool to one of many tools, but we'll look at other writing activities, obviously, but that's a good one to get you going. Speaking of which, for continuous professional development, which Rosalía mentioned there, don't hesitate in going to, is this on Future Learn, I think? It's a free course for teaching English online and a very good course, actually, that runs, it's going to run again soon, I think, Rosalía, you said?
I think so, because it's been so popular. I mean, thousands and thousands of people, of colleagues have watched it. It really is very good. I was very happy when I was actually one of the people interacting with the participants at one time, mm-hmm. Jonny, and it was amazing. I mean, it was like, oops, hundreds of questions and comments and feedback, etc. It was really very good. And talking to people from all sorts of different places. And then becoming, I remember, very moved when I found people who were colleagues of mine several years ago, people from other countries I had met at the different event, etc. So highly recommended.
So yeah, feel free to check that out and register. So this will be interesting. Do you remember the six? We were looking at the virtuous circle today, which is designing, delivering, and evaluating learning. The other three were the digital world, I believe, the digital teacher.
Classroom and the digital teacher. That's right. Teacher.
And so what we'd ask you to do on Monday, and we reminded you on Tuesday, if it was possible for you to do that, is for you to go onto the digital teacher website and for you to do the self-evaluation. So we have a very quick kind of bit of feedback here, and I'm going to seamlessly go to Mentimeter. You're not even going to notice, Rosalía. Just going to seamlessly do that.
Okay.
And what we're going to ask you are two questions, essentially. So the first question, and if you, for those that are new with us today, most of you will have already been here, but for those that are new, if you go to menti.com, preferably on your mobile phones, and then you put in the code 5752012. It's right at the top there. So let's have a little go. What we're asking you, what were your strong areas out of those six when you did the self-assessment on the digital teacher? Be honest with yourself. You know, it's good to be
shy.
Good at something.
Nobody will see your name.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't have to be the specific areas. It could be just certain aspects that you saw that were your strong areas. And in the next slide, we're going to ask you to consider your weak areas. Excellent. Evaluating. Delivering. Excellent. There we go.
Creativity. That's such a lovely word. So important too. Patience. So important. Especially when you're using technology, right, Jonny?
Definitely.
All the stories can tell.
We've got some coming. The code is at the top of the screen. Can you see the code there, Rosalía? The code that is at the top?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So if you're struggling with the code, then it's 5752012. And I've just got to move some things to get the end of it.
1 2.
Yeah. 1 2, sorry. Yeah.
Digital skills. Okay. Very interesting.
Very interesting. Yeah, patient. So I'm quite interested as well in
planning
the next...
games. Good.
Give 30 seconds more, because there are more than 80. We're a lot more than 80.
Empathy, so... which is so important.
Mm-hmm.
Kindness.
Okay. 20 seconds, Rosalía, do you think?
Yeah, at least 15. Hardworking. Okay, this is important too. And everybody's working so hard now because, I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? The fact that we are at home, we seem to be working longer hours and more all the time. We start earlier and finish much later than we usually did when we were going to the office, Jonny.
And the reason we did this as a word cloud is just to get a real range of opinions, so it wasn't just a multiple choice in this sense. So it's good that you've expanded on what we were saying. I'm going to stop that one now, and we're going to go to the second question, which you should be able to, now those people are on the app, you should be able to, or the website, you should be able to just go on. So we've changed slide, go to that. So which areas are in need of improvement? We might get some of the same ones here, which this proves something that this is interesting, because what we were saying yesterday was that.
Okay, good. No, that is interesting because some people say I'm very good at these, and some people and some people are saying just the opposite, right? I should really work on getting these better.
Which is why teaching communities are so important, and this is the point we're kind of trying to make here, that people have different strengths and weaknesses. Teachers are no exception to that. So you can always pick the brains of colleagues who are probably, some of them are friends, some of them might just be colleagues, but fine, have weekly or fortnightly meetings to be able to exchange ideas. Very interesting that we're seeing, a clear trend that there are certain things that some people are very good at and some people feel they need to
planning.
Improve still.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's, and planning is so important when it comes to digital ecology, Jonny.
It is. And we're all about being aim-based rather than resource heavy, aren't we? Looking to get those outcomes rather than just filling the time with 53 activities. Okay. In the interest of time, I know the people are writing, so I'll give 10 seconds just to finish and get your view on there. It's good for us to capture this. We can look at that as later as well, Rosalía. You
And
and I
just to
will have a
say, if you're one of those who wrote digital skills, you've come to the right session because and you know where to go. The digital teacher will be your ally, your friend, your companion, and it will help you get better and better all the time. I have to confess, I haven't read everything that's available there because there's so much. And that's the idea. You don't have to try and read and go through everything. Just in 1 week and in a month, etc. You go there and go back and explore, right?
Yeah, it's meant to be, and it's meant to be a springboard, not a solution, or like a full solution. So before we get going, and not just in terms of the presentation, but also for your classes, so there are some important areas to consider, aren't there, Rosalia? And
Oh,
it's great
yes.
to get running. It's great to start competing or to start teaching in this case. But we need to be quite well prepared. That's partly what this series is about, to give some structure around that with the digital teacher. But when we're looking specifically about designing, delivering, and evaluating learning, there are some areas that we thought were important to highlight before we got into the ideas, really. So these concepts shouldn't be anything new to you, but we think they're specifically contextually very important more than ever. I always started off courses with needs analysis and needs assessments. Analysis, you can get some idea of what people like to do, what they need their English for, what motivates them, what doesn't. An assessment, looking at the actual level, so looking at the language itself, and well, are they an A2, are they an A1 plus, that kind of thing.
Oh,
That's
yeah.
important, right? More than ever, we're going to have students with different levels of support at home, so you're gonna have to take into consideration those kind like evaluating ch certain checkpoints throughout a course to see that everybody is managing to progress as well as they can. And also availability of resources. This is something we always go on about, isn't it, Rosalia?
Yeah, definitely. If you ask your learners, so you've got a laptop at home, you've got a computer, etc., etc. The fact that they're saying yes, Johnny, maybe doesn't include also the fact that it's the same laptop that they are sharing with three other brothers and sisters, right?
Exactly.
Or that the internet at home is very slow and they sometimes lose the connection, etc., etc., right? So we have to be very patient. Somebody said patience is a great virtue. Yes, definitely, because even if they have got the devices, the resources, etc., they may not have the time, right? It would be great if we could say, okay, this is our learners. Okay, so Juanito is part of a family of five, so it's Juanito and another brother and a sister, etc. But how many laptops have they got? Or is it if it's one of those schools where, for example, all the learners have access to their own iPads because it was a school requirement, that is great, but that is not the same context for everybody, right? So we
Yeah,
have to be patient and careful.
if anything, this should be made a little bit easier by things being delivered online. So a needs analysis and needs assessment can just be a simple online form that is facilitated by your learning platform, or a questionnaire that you send to parents and ask them to complete, depending on the age of the students, particularly for the
Yes.
analysis part. Like, what subjects do they like talking about? What don't they like talking about? What interests and hobbies do they have? These kind of things. And the availability of resources as well as part of that kind of means assessment, what's available for students. Probably good to speak to parents about that, maybe as part of a parent's online chat, and then during that, get them to complete that form. And instead of having millions of different pieces of paper, you just get the results, and then you can dip into the results and see, for
Exactly.
Juanito or for Rosalba or whoever. So,
Exactly. And just to say, somebody, for example, and this is a very important thing, Marta is saying, what if it's a very old computer they have? Yeah. Right? That is important to remember. And yes, Edgar, Menti is something wonderful to use with your learners. So explore it and start using it. We highly recommend it, as you can see. And that's why we've been trying to show you different ways that you can use it. You get the word cloud. Today, I think we're going with word clouds, Johnny, but we've had the web, we've had the donut, the different things, all different possibilities.
I think the idea is to use something that offers the chance for students to volunteer some information themselves and have some ownership over the learning process. That could be with quizzes or with surveys that were done as a group, as long as they're anonymous and that you have some sort of profanity filter on them. So you don't risk having kind of naughty
feedback. Some colleagues may have not heard about the profanity filter. This is something very important, because especially with teenagers, right? But it helps everybody. It just makes it impossible for them to use words that you wouldn't be using in the classroom usually, right?
Yeah. And so to wrap this up, it's a case of saying, okay, it's a challenging race ahead. There'll be some unknowns, but some things that we can do at the beginning will help smooth out any potential bumps. And it's also easy to collect that information than it ever has been before, reaching parents and stuff like that. So, I mean, I think there's big opportunity in starting off on the right foot, basically. And so that brings us on to the first area, or the first element or component or realm, galaxies we were talking about yesterday. With designing learning.
I apologize for the stormtroopers, but I think I've made up for that today. Everybody will see.
Rosalía deleted a stormtrooper's picture from the presentation yesterday, so I was upset with her. But so some fundamental areas to consider when you're starting to design your classes, or your month's worth of classes, or your term, or whoever your institution and you plan, is thinking about these four areas. First of all, we were talking about slow computer earlier. Do you need to be live online for the full duration? Probably not. I mean, as long as you've got key learning outcomes that have been explained to parents and to students, and that there are expectations and ways of measuring that, that's the key. Not that you see the teacher's face for 100% of the lesson. So giving people time to do activities when they're just closing maybe the chat space they're in, they're doing an activity for 15 minutes. If it's something that kind of alleviates the bandwidth a little bit. If it's something that you can monitor because you're on the same platform as them, that's even better. We also need to consider interaction, which we're going to look at in the subsequent slides. But, you know, just because we are immediately presented with a class in front of us on a screen doesn't mean we have to just interact with them like that. You wouldn't do that in a conventional classroom because it wouldn't be basically a good idea. And neither is it a good idea to do that online. Just be me, teacher, speaking to the whole class or speaking with the whole class.
Boring.
50 or 60 minutes. Totally boring. And we're sorry as well that we can't interact with you. There are just so many of you that we can't facilitate that. But with a class of 30 or 25, it would be perfect.
How about you trying not to make it boring?
We're trying our very best. We'll look at some key features to consider when design learning. One of them could be argued is that element of personalization and that element of ownership and involvement from learners.
And that's so important because we all enjoy talking about ourselves, right? And this is something absolutely wonderful that Jonny and I wanted to share with you today. This is something new. I think I've already mentioned in the case of Cambridge and Michigan, we use Microsoft Teams. We know that many of you use other platforms like Zoom or Moodle or Google, et cetera, right? But this is something that it's been possible to start using. If you see, I mean, this is if you teach adults, right? So if you're in higher education or upper secondary schools, that would be our prepas here, especially after they become of age, right? 18 or older, those students, then you can use these. And we know it's not a real classroom, right? But this is what it can look like. And it makes a difference.
And somebody, when we were discussing this today, somebody very cleverly said you could even, if they were younger learners or teen learners, to be honest, even adults, avatars.
Exactly.
Somebody doesn't have their, so you could have people with avatars. That could be quite an interesting online experience as well.
Creativity is something that everybody enjoys using, right? So give it as a chance for your learners to create their own avatar.
And so you're faced with a class like this, or you feel like you are. This is a great dynamic to have, obviously, but it's also good to mix that up a little bit so it's not so repetitive. So
you have a commercial there for Herbert.
I do. Well, we're going to see Herbert in the next slide as well, but Herbert, you can say his surname better than I can. Buchta.
Buchta.
He is there's a that's the title of the webinar there. It's a fantastic webinar on exactly what it says, but basically this is from 2 or 3 months ago, looking at interaction patterns basically and how it interact with students and parents. Some fantastic tips there, and he's able to go into the type of detail that unfortunately we can't go into today, which is why we've left that there. But thinking about
And just to remind everybody, Johnny, if I may, that everybody will also be getting the list of all the different resources and references that we have quoted here, all the different links, etc. So something to look forward to coming to you next week.
Definitely. And one area I'd be interested in exploring is the instruction delivering instructions. So mixing this up a little bit, so it's just not your voice going on and on and on and on with students. Maybe you're going to try delivering, we looked at yesterday, speaking quickly and speaking slowly. Maybe that's a way of doing it. Or writing them out on the screen or in the chat. Maybe even getting them to put the instructions in order. If you have a jumbled up phrase, that appeals to certain type of students and learner styles. They'd be quite good at maybe putting a phrase in order, but other skills they're not so good at, so it's a good piece of achievement for them. You might also use phonetic script with certain instructions. That could be a nice way just to get them thinking and using different parts of their brains. We were looking at neurobics yesterday and how variety is a spice of life. Bringing that into the classroom is certainly beneficial.
Oh, yes. And do remember, we can see your. When I'm doing this, don't worry, I'm not watching something on Netflix. I'm just trying, Johnny and I are trying to see whether you have any questions, any comments, and we'll be very happy to try and answer all your questions or make reference to what you're saying or suggesting to all the
Yeah,
other
we'll do the
colleagues.
best. We'll do the best we can. We've got a lot to get through, but yeah, we will keep an eye on that. And if we can't answer it as we're going, we'll answer it maybe in the resources that we send out after the webinars. But basically, and again, definitely encourage you to go and look at Herbert's webinar.
Absolutely.
You'll see there that he said for teacher-led instruction, there are certain things that are definitely worth keeping that interaction of me and the class. So things like housekeeping, explaining tasks, definitely makes total sense. Clarifying language, whether that's pre or post activity, and storytelling are all optimal when they're done basically in a teacher-led way. At
And
least
can I
when you're
say,
getting going.
Johnny? That when we say storytelling, this doesn't mean that we're only talking about young learners.
Not at
Storytelling
all.
is for all ages.
Absolutely. No, because you could be telling an anecdote. I used to do like a running dictation, well, a running dictogloss, where I'd tell an anecdote about something that had happened to me. And then you'd be able to, they'd have to be going back and telling partners and writing it down. You could implement that online as well by just having a fast or a slow dictation. But definitely, or just a story, an interesting anecdote. And then they've got a quiz at the end or as you're going to answer questions about it.
Lovely
But yeah,
idea, yeah.
totally agree. I mean, obviously, storytelling for young learners is brilliant. Things like the Gruffalo, I think you could still manage to storytell online if you had music, if you had some sort of props going on, or you got students to have certain props. So they'd have to lift up certain items when you said certain words. You'd have to think about this when you're, again, when you're designing that learning. But yeah, definitely encourage storytelling. Who doesn't like a good story, Rosalia?
Ah. We all love stories.
Absolutely. That's what we live for. So, but also don't forget pair work, which is shown here, and also group work and group breakout rooms. We've told have been successful. Definitely, if there's a specific task that they need to come back and report to the group on, that is ideal. You might have learners that are study partners for a week or 2 weeks, so that you're helping students with certain strengths and weaknesses, pair off, and really kind of help each other out, really.
Exactly. And just to remind everybody, you will be getting the links to see all the recorded webinars, not just for this week, but all the different ones we've had. And that includes Herbert's webinar
Yes.
that Johnny has been talking about.
Absolutely. Oof. What's going on here, Rosalia?
What's going on, Johnny, is I've said to you the font size. Come on. I wear thick glasses. Think of me.
Even for me with not so thick glasses,
How'd you go like that? Yeah. So do
So
you like that? Do you really, really like that? And more importantly, can you really read?
well, I'm
I'm
gonna
joking, obviously.
can I make a confession?
Okay,
This
go ahead.
was a slide of mine, wasn't it? And we're using this as an example of probably not the best practice. Yeah, too much going on
Exactly.
there. Virginia agrees. She said, "Nope." So we're introducing a jigsaw reading, something that can be done quite easily online. In fact, probably more effectively and a bit less
Oh,
confusingly for the
yeah,
teacher.
absolutely.
For those, a brief definition of a jigsaw reading would be the same reading. It's split into pieces, depending on the level and the length of the text, obviously, the level of the students. And people have got different pieces of information they need to find, and then they come back together in the same room, breakout room, or into the main room, or with you, and ask each other so they get the full information about the text. So they might have, you might have 10 spaces, for example, that they need to end up filling. Five and five, and they come back together and do that. But we wouldn't present it like this, would we, Rosalia? That's what we're saying.
No, of course. I'm sure you can improve it, Johnny.
What about
Oh,
this?
much better. Much better.
That, yeah, you prefer that? We could
Totally.
have that. Yeah, we could do one of my favorite things is a picture reveal where you could on a white scribble over that picture and start deleting the scribble little by little so that students then have to guess what it is, for instance. Or you put panels over there and just drag them off. You have numbered panels. You've seen me with this activity before, haven't you, Rosalie? I do like it. Where you hide the picture and maybe you're asking them some vocabulary questions or just some recap questions. And if they get the question right, they can then pick a tile for you to remove. And there's a prize or there are points or something like that. But
Really, very nice idea.
to introduce a jigsaw, this might be a lovely way of doing it. You could maybe have a race in 30 seconds, write down what you can see or which colors can you see. There are all kinds of things that you could do, or how many different board games can you name? Maybe not many, depending on the age of the class or the hobbies they have at home. But we think this is a nicer way of introducing it, a visual first approach. And then this is the same slide as a couple of slides ago, but what we've done here is stripped out the text. So we've gone for just content, really important content words. And that gives us a bit more of a straightforward kind of skeleton of the activity. So
It makes it
this
actually possible for people to read
it
what's
does.
there.
You'll never forgive me for that slide, will you?
Never. But just remember, I mean, you've heard me say, I think only about half a million times. When you are presenting, when you're using a PowerPoint, when you have slides, and you have lots of text, you have 27 lines of text. What do you want? Do you want the people who are listening to you to listen to you, or do you want them to stop listening to you because they're so busy reading?
We want them to listen, don't we? We don't want to be speaking to them for 60 minutes, as we've said before. You've got to vary that interaction. When it's teacher talk, when you do have some teacher talking time, if it's to basically set up an activity, you want to really maximize it so that you're not losing them. They've got short attention spans at all kinds of levels, even adult classes sometimes. But yeah, have something simple, have something that is maybe visual first or maybe hinting at what it is so they have to guess and they start thinking. This brings into activating something that Rosalia loves talking about.
Activating schemata, of course.
Absolutely,
That's
absolutely.
so important.
But
Okay.
we've got, if you go onto the Michigan YouTube, you'll see a nice walkthrough of how to do a jigsaw reading online. So we could
And
go
you're
into
also
it here.
getting the link.
Absolutely, but we don't want to give you the whole treatment here. It's there for you to take a look at. And this touches on the theme we've been saying. You can't design a class that's going to be just you as the superstar. Some of you, all of you, are superstars. Some of you might have students that think, "Wow, you are superstars." But it doesn't mean that you have to be in the camera for 60 or more minutes every class. And so, how do we avoid that? Well, we've given you some ideas so far, and this is a bit of a kind of summary of them. You could use pre-recorded video so that it becomes a different type of interaction with you and it's not live. There's less pressure on having to understand stuff. They can rewind obviously, in it, well, not re, don't you don't say rewind now, but they can replay the video or whatever, or go to the part that they can't understand. That's good practice for listening skills. We should allow students to interact in that way with listening audio, so that they can really focus on the areas they're struggling with. So pre-recorded videos to set up activities is fantastic. It's a great idea. Getting them to do projects is a great way as well. Maybe you could have a project slot in every lesson, or every couple of lessons, where it's 15 minutes or 10 minutes if they're doing some research on a certain area, where you're able to then feed back with a presentation or a little kind of booklet, or I don't know, a PowerPoint presentation or something probably more imaginative. People use Canvas and all kinds of things these days, or even something like, I don't know, something like a short video for them to present something. But yeah, getting to do project works, again, stops you being that kind of center of attention. Getting them to do reading tasks within documents or platforms where you can see they're answering the questions. Again, just go off the platform if they can, or switch their video off, switch their sound off, do the activity. It's just that change of dynamic, so they're not just, they don't feel like they have to be like this constantly with you. Yeah. And
I also, as we've said, Jonny, try and give them opportunities for the learners to actually ask the questions. They're so used to answering questions, sometimes they find it a bit challenging to come up with questions themselves.
Yes, exactly. And to scaffold that, if you've got students that are quite low level, give them the beginning of questions that they need to kind of write down in a notebook and try to work out what the question is. Or, as we mentioned earlier, reordering the questions. And timed, well, that's a timely mention, but timed exercises, so that there's a kind of a bit of a kind of dynamic to the class where it's like you've got 5 minutes, guys, and there's a clock on there for them to be aware of to do something. Or you get, if they're switching off their cameras or going onto a different platform or something, then you give them 5 minutes, and on the, everybody has to be back after 5 minutes. You get them to set a timer. And as we've said, maybe flipping the classroom a little bit, getting them to read, listen, or watch something before the class. You might guide this with certain questions, and then they have to come in and report. So there isn't that kind of switch off time where they're like, oh, it's fine, we've got to do exercises, and right at the end of the class, we're going to speak. No, 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 no. You've done that kind of research and reading before the class. As soon as you get to class, it could be you that's going to be speaking.
We suggested, for example, the virtual tour of Museo Sumaya yesterday, right?
Exactly.
That was a very nice example of flipping the classroom.
Totally. Yeah, totally agree with you.
A very nice, well, it was our idea. So I'm saying it's very nice, but I...
But it works. You give them a task. It's like task-based learning and flipping the classroom. You give them a task, they go and do it. In this, it could be with on their own or with a learning study partner or within a group, and then they have to report back, and that's positive. It gets them interacting with English and being ready to do something as soon as they hit the class. Now, this is quite a nice one. People were mentioning earlier about having problems with getting students to evaluating writing and getting students to do writing in class. This is, again, it will go beyond the resources handout. This is a website called Storyboard That. It's freemium to premium. The free stuff is excellent. It's more than enough for the purpose of an English language classroom. I really like this.
And that's this always something... the best way to go about it, Jonny. Don't start with the premium version. Just start with the free stuff and see what you can get, because most of the times you get all the free stuff and that's more than enough, really.
It is, and with this, you can create a story. You can put in backgrounds or cityscapes, countryside, beach, characters, that's all great. Kinds of things. You could even have crazy aliens in a classroom on there, whatever. This could be a homework where you say you need to have your three pictures, and I want you to write two or three sentences describing what's happening, and a dialogue or a thought bubble. And then they come in and they present it, and you know, they have to review each other's stories. There are so many things you can do with, again, storytelling. Who doesn't love it?
I'm really
bad at drawing. You know, in a creative class, you could get students to draw.
But you've managed to do a shark when you've been challenged, Jonny.
I think
you're a bit frozen.
Showing some drawing. Am I back?
Okay. Is it me or is it you?
Let me
That
see.
reminds me of the joke of the person who's drunk and said,
No,
I
I'm not,
think
we're
you
both
might be
moving.
drunk.
We're both moving. It's fine.
You look fuzzy. Okay, it might be only me.
But
Right, so yes.
this is a cool resource. Three pictures is enough, I would say, and they can put lots of different things in each picture, and it can be a nice springboard for
Okay,
creative writing.
Jonny, I'm being told by our wonderful marketing colleagues, we have two wonderful Monica marketing colleagues who are backstage making sure that everything happens. It was you who got frozen, and just I think it's a great moment to say this can happen to you too. All of you who are listening, you're not infallible. It happens. I mean, we've talked about technology. It's something that can do, right? So you may not notice that yourself, but it can happen, right? But don't be nervous. I mean,
I'm
we
not
can do
disheartened.
anything
I'm not
about it.
disheartened. It's fine. It's fine. But yeah,
Absolutely, yeah.
just to look at some features. This again is a bit of a summary slide of some of the things we've been talking about today and yesterday. We've got an example of my artistic achievements in a slide coming up for using whiteboards in fun and creative ways. We think study groups and breakout rooms can work very well. Share documents because you can actually see if they're editing or not. I think that's pretty cool. Maybe I've got a bit of a big brother, a bit of a
Here.
big brother appetite in me, but I think that's good. Previously, if a student was handing you a piece of work, they could say they'd spent 3 hours on it, and you look at it and you think that's a 5 minute piece of work. Whereas if they're doing it in a shared document where you can see how many times they visited the page, what edits they've done, you can really start to tap in. And that in itself is a form of evaluating writing, that kind of formative assessment to dip in and say, oh, look, you've changed this. That's great. Oh, but here you haven't changed that, or you've changed it the wrong way. Let me explain what's going on there. And also polls and quizzes or things like Mentimeter that can just break up the dynamic a bit are also advisable. And generators, like the one we saw on the previous slide, which is a bit more visual. This one could be something for an older audience. It's a kind of plot generator where you can put in all kinds of parameters and it randomly gives you character names. Because I'm not very creative with stuff like that. Whereas if I was given the character names, if I was given the place or the setting, I could probably start writing. Whereas if not, I'd
You
be like,
say you're
oh.
not creative, Jonny, but you are. Whenever I challenge you, and usually when I do it in public, and you have no idea that I'm going to challenge you, you react so positively and you are creative. Give
Oh, thank
yourself
you.
credit.
I'll give myself a pat on the back.
Exactly.
Okay. And another feature that you might want to
Oh, I
incorporate,
love this.
yeah, is thinking of a daily basis, thinking about what are you going to get students to do every day. This is an example from a Michigan MET Go. It's a calendar that we have that can help parents and students to be able to have activities that are ready and quite simple as well to be able to pick up and do that at home. We've got one for young learners and all and one and the same I think for Michigan young learners. Check them out. I think this is a lovely activity or a range of activities. This gives you a bit of a clearer look about the kind of things it's saying. Number one, guess who was part of the one of writing this, Rosalía? A vocabulary back, a vocabulary box, or vocabulary bag. I used to love this as a teacher saying, collect vocabulary. And if you get them on cards, and this is something the parents are aware of, you can get them to do vocabulary games like matching activities. Again, just breaking that dynamic up so they're not looking at the screen all the time.
And even things, I mean, everybody can have sort of different ideas. Like I was thinking today, like bring something from the fridge. This is why it's so important to talk to parents, by the way. I cannot emphasize this enough. So they say if they open the fridge and they take something out and show it to the camera, it's because we're asking them to do that, right? And maybe do make a game out of it, etc. And I'm very happy with this the 30-day activity idea, Johnny, because we've got a Michigan 30-day planner. We've also got a Cambridge 30-day planner, and we're going to share both links, so don't worry. And for the colleague who asked about the jigsaw reading, Evelyn, you're going to get that. Johnny mentioned that there is a it's a video, right? It's a Michigan video where you explain the activity. Okay, so you're also going to get that.
Absolutely.
And much more.
Check it out, even if it's just as little pieces of homework. But I quite like the MET. I mean, the MET Go Challenge could last a whole term, or the Young Learner Challenge could last a whole term. You've got 30 activities there that have been.
You don't have to do them in that order. This is just a recommendation.
Yes.
You don't have to do all of them if you think, oh, this is too basic, I don't like this one, etc.
But it might inspire you for some activities in class as well. You could leave some for homework and do some in class or as projects. That, for example, recording yourself reading a short poem or short story, sorry, a poem or short story. I think that's quite a cool one. And it could even be a little piece of homework that they send to you recorded, and it gives you some chance to evaluate their spoken fluency.
Time another bit of a torturing you.
I know we're going to rattle through the rest, but we went out a little bit over yesterday, so we won't rush too much. This was in yesterday's presentation, so we're just highlighting it again. We had somebody.
But we like
saying,
it better and better all the time.
We do, and it's a brilliant landing page with all of the areas that you can see there about socially distanced classroom, emotional support for learners, their stuff for preparing for exams. There's everything you could think of on there. So for those at the beginning that were saying, you know, some go-to web pages, I would recommend this one as a key one, wouldn't you, Rosalía? It's been really well thought out.
Absolutely. Really very and good. So happy about it.
Although this shows a non-virtual classroom, we are big fans of using students as a resource.
May so I have say, to be... whenever I say this, I say this in a really positive way. Let's exploit our learners.
Absolutely. Their experiences, their opinions.
They get bored because they're not doing anything. They're only listening to you. And if they're young, if they're very young, of course they will get bored. So let's get them to do something, right? Lots of the different things that you can do. They should be doing that.
Yeah, so quizzes, for example, even if it's them creating the content and then maybe narrating, if it's you that's got the Kahoot account or something like that, they could still be the presenters. They could even dress up for it or have certain props. And if they've done 5 questions on certain vocabulary where they need to fill in the gap, then you can be the one passing, going through the Kahoot. But they might be the ones presenting it and give them some support in language so they can be like a mini TV presenter. But yeah, at every opportunity possible, how can we get students involved and exploit them in the best way possible?
Jonny, when we do the webinar on Christmas activities, you and I should really wear something interesting, something Christmassy.
Oh, my word. Okay. That's brilliant. So do that live, and then I just say, yes, of course. So that sounds interesting. So always, again,
remember that Jonny said he's not very good at drawing. That's why.
Yeah, look in the top right-hand corner. This is me doing some Pictionary drawings. But basically, the idea here is to say you can give control to, again, the digital environment gives you a bit more control over that control. You can give them control of the learning process, you know, very specific control. And that could be drawing certain vocabulary from certain units or from a vocabulary bag they've got or the vocabulary collection you've got as a class, getting them leading on the hangman. And giving them the support in language. We've got some examples there, like, I have no idea what it is, which is often the response to my drawings, or what is that, Jonny? And deliberately put in italics, because you might want to drill some of this language and put the stress on, like the kind of the sentence level stress, you might be saying, or the question within a question, which words is getting stressed, get some drilling before you do it, and then it becomes a bit more looser and a bit more fun for the students. I have another nice one, which isn't here, but the shark one that Rosalía mentioned is where it could be a shark or alligator. I used to draw for a hangman, which hangman, everybody's done it fine. You know, it's nothing new. But this was a tip from a Canadian teacher I used to work with where she said, oh, I draw myself and elicit it from the students to start with. Maybe they draw me or they tell me how to draw myself, or I draw it and they have to guess who it is. It has to be you, obviously. You'll find out why. And then draw some steps going down and then some water and some sharks, some shark fins. Works fantastically with primary.
And of course, if it's your learners, they always want the shark to eat you.
They do, unfortunately. So the hangman remains, but instead of hanging the man, it's Jonny or Rosalía or whoever, Marta, going down the steps. And so there's all kinds of things you can introduce there because it's personalized at the class level. You go, I'm so sad. Why do you treat me like this? Don't you like this kind of language? And have a bit of a laugh with them. They'll find it funny. Or if you wanted to put a positive spin on it, you could make it like a computer game where you've got platforms to jump on, and then you get the kind of, you open the treasure chest at the end or something like that. You know, if you do, I totally accept some people might not like teaching, you know, going down to the sharks, or parents might not. Fine. Do it going upwards towards like a prize at the end. But yes, maybe he moves up once they get the letter instead of going down where they don't get a letter. So we can think creatively and adapt to things that we already do.
And please, please go and start using those Kahoots for young learners. They're absolutely adorable.
They are. Ready to roll as well, I think, aren't they?
Oh yes, absolutely.
So with videos, there's so much you can do as well. Again, you might want to set this for homework because of bandwidth issues, but you could do it in terms of senses or in terms of visuals if you're looking at certain kind of lexical items, or even just basic narration, like what happened first, what happened second, what happened third, then what happened, these kind of guided questions so they watch it in their own time and then report back. You got a half watching and half not watching, or vice, or give them conflicting, well, not conflicting, but give them different clips to watch, and then they report back and maybe decide which clip sounds more interesting between them.
Conflicting could be an option, but I suppose I would do that with older learners.
Yeah, and it could be, in thinking about it, you could have two videos that I don't know if they even exist, like spot the difference videos. You know, you could have something like that that you set for homework, but I don't know. I know that spot the difference definitely exists, and your friend Gad Lim, one of our colleagues, used to love doing spot the difference and things in a paper as a child, which is why it's obviously worked well for him. all these brain activities as a young Gad. But yeah, maybe even if it was videos where they have to spot what was similar, what was different, even if they're fairly similar videos, but with some differences.
Yeah.
Also, we like stuff like this, don't we? This is another borrowed. This is another borrowed activity that we really liked, and we thought we'd share it with you.
Yes, and this is like Nick Peachy, right? And we're going to share the link where you can find that. This was an idea. What's my story? It's just one photograph. This time you don't get to share the story or to tell the story to your learners. They see these, and this is what should get them going, right? And you can do these individually if it's a small group. You could do these in pairs. You could do these in small groups, right? So lots of different things that can happen. So you see that old bike. How long has it been there? Who left it there? How did this happen? Was it abandoned? Was it stolen? Oh, mystery, Jonny.
Intrigue. I mean, everybody loves that. Students,
I love
do.
A mystery.
Going into groups, see who can come up with the most bizarre story, or see who's, you know, you could have a vote at the end, or even share those stories with a different class and get them to vote on which story they like the most, or which one they thought was most interesting. So then it takes away from you and you're not having to judge. But it's a lovely idea to like put, take an inanimate object and get them really tapping into their imagination. Speaking of imagination, this is a nice segue. we've got a thank you, Herbert, at the top again, because this is, you'll see this if you go to his webinar when we send you the link. Unboxing, which is quite a common thing now, and it's a bit of a kind of influencer thing or whatever on YouTube. But for a monologue, for a 1 minute to 2 minute spoken piece of discourse, this is a great opportunity in the classroom. You've got the definition there. It's basically taking something out of a box and describing it as you go. That's probably more interesting for students. It's a bit more tactile. It's a bit more personal than some of the other speaking activities that we tend to do. So I think that this is a great inclusion here. And we thank your dear friend Herbert for this. I think it's a lovely idea. They can unbox a range of things.
When it comes to the word itself, I think it's a waste of a new word, because we already had something like unpacking, right? What was wrong with unpacking?
And I think I've got something I'm going to... What was I going to... I was going to unbox something here for us, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Can we unbox it now?
Well, this would obviously go along with a whole dialogue, but it's actually Stormtrooper from an egg, which I thought was quite a nice way of symbolizing unboxing, even if it's with an egg. But This isn't just a quick
This is
activity.
part of the salute to stormtroopers because I deleted Johnny's slide yesterday. I'm sorry, Johnny.
Absolutely. I know. But I forgive you. So it's
just,
not
before we go on, can I just say, can people please, and you can use the questions box for these. Can you tell me, I've been using a word deliberately that it's not a word that I usually use. It's more of a Johnny word, right? I think you will agree with me, Johnny, right?
Well, apparently it is my word, yeah.
And this is something that you can do. Remember when I said it can be very tedious sometimes. You go lesson after lesson after lesson. So I said, what I usually do is I challenge myself to do something. And I mentioned the example, for example, years ago when cricket, my son was younger, I said, okay, I'm going to Colima, I'm going to Guadalajara, etc. I'm talking to teachers, it's a plenary, it's a whatever, right? And I say, I'll mention your name. So I made sure that when I was talking, when I was presenting, there was a context that was ideal for saying something. Oh, for example, my son cricket, da, 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 right? And this time I said, I will use this word that you use all the time, Johnny, because it's not a word that I use. It's not part of the Rosalía dialect, right? It's more part of the Johnny dialect. Can anybody guess what word it is that I have been using? And I think if I had told you from the very beginning, it would have been too easy for you because you must have realized that I used the word and then I started laughing and trying very hard not to laugh.
We'll leave it for now and see if they can guess it.
Absolutely.
And so what we said about unboxing is it's not a 5-minute activity. There's lots of language work that can go on beforehand. You can look at lexical groups.
Yes, that is, you're right. Absolutely.
But this is a really creative task. It's good for presentation skills. Word planting, which is essentially what Rosalie is talking about there, is something you can do, or phrase planting to say, these are the stem sentences or the words that I would like you to include in this. And you could even have a list, a card that they wrote, or even a dictation that you say, right, I've given you all 10 words. Here they are, or 10 phrases or 5 phrases. Listen to, I don't know, Marcello giving an unboxing, or look at his video and tick when you hear them. So you could turn it into an active listening activity as well. We're going to have to really start pushing on here because we might run over a little bit. I hope you don't mind people watching, just so we can give some, just so we can properly explain some of these things. So speculation, Rosalía, take it away because this is one of yours.
Okay, what is it, Jonny? You know, so don't say anything, but people who are watching this, what is it? You just get this photograph and you see it and you say, is it something ugly? Is it something smelly? Is it something that you traditionally use? What is it? Do you know? It's something you can find at home.
So as we're waiting, we've got somebody got it, did they?
Not part of a nest, but that's a very interesting answer. Yarn and a needle. Absolutely, yes. And of course, to the people who said absolutely, they were absolutely right. Absolutely is a Johnny word rather than a Rosalía word.
You're going to give me some sort of complex note with that. I'm coming out of this with a drama. But yeah, this is great for just a bit. It's fun, but actually, again, with vocabulary that maybe you're recycling. Is it it could be, I'm not sure, or what do you think? All these kind of chunks of words and clusters you can have and continually revisit with these kind of activities.
We've got another one. And you can do it, as you said, what sort of level? It can be at the very basic level because it's a very natural way for the is it a question to happen, right? And sometimes we find it a bit like too prefabricated, right? The context that we have for the is it an question. So next one, people.
Can you guess this one? What are we looking at here? Yeah, you could even have it as, is it something you find and then you practice?
Is it my collection of earrings? I have a famous collection of earrings, which I cannot wear now because I'm wearing the big headphones, right?
We've got some good guesses there, but I was just going to say, Rosalie, you could even have it with locations or preparations of place as a kind of, as a sort of a drill in a sense. So is it something you find at or in or on?
Exactly. You can give them more help, and that's always
Yeah.
good. So yes, mini, mini stones, Ana Maria. But yes, some people
They got
like
sand.
Rebecca, they've got sand.
And
You're
that's what it was, yeah.
absolutely right.
So shared documents we looked at earlier and we said loads of things you can do there. Those are some ideas. Just because of time, we won't spend too long on here. But basically making it a bit more student and process driven, the writing process, so it's not just kind of a prompt and an answer. You could have them in work, in study groups, like we said. So you've got group leaders in those study groups that maybe report back or collect things together. And when we talk about writing, we can also talk about writing, which is basically maybe just at sentence level. So not at paragraph level or at text level, but asking them to create sentences based using vocabulary that you've covered. This seems to be vocabulary from a holiday unit. So again, you've got the spaces for them, they go there. And you could even make it a race, and then you go in and check and see how well people have done.
Great. Minus 2 minutes, Johnny.
I know, I know. We touched on this earlier when we had the picture of the teacher in front of the whiteboard speaking to the class, and we said, get them to create the quizzes. So even that sounds complicated, but as we saw in the last slide, just at sentence level, so it's a quiz that you can put onto Kahoot or whatever platform you use, whatever kind of Quizlet or whatever. And get them to generate the content. So using them as a resource, saying, this group, you need to come up with 10 phrases from unit one, which is about holidays, and then something about personal information or where I live. This other group, you're going to do that. And they come forward and they have to quiz the class, basically. You could do it as a sort of online quiz, on-screen quiz, or you could do it orally. So you're teaching them to listen to each other, which is an important thing in teaching, so that they're not just hooked onto your voice, but they're actually paying respect and listening to other people, which is something that they're going to have to do throughout their life. And we think there's a lot of merit in having either pairs or groups. We saw earlier that some of you have strengths which are other people's weaknesses, and vice versa. So why not collaborate, and why not try to encourage that kind of approach and mentality from a young age?
Yeah.
Evaluating, we're getting on to. We're not going to ask you that question just for time purposes, because we're going to try and wrap up in the next few minutes. I know we're running over, so I apologize for that. Two types of assessment, Rosalia.
Exactly. And we usually talk about formative and summative, right? And it's very important. Assessment for learning is not the same as assessment of learning. You want to see how everything is going. We're talking about formative assessment. It's assessment that will help you decide how to go on journey. It's assessment that will help you see, evaluate progress, etc. Whereas at the end of the year, at the end of the semester, at the end of something that you had in mind, you have to see how far they managed to get, right? Both are
Probably to
important. Different
both.
contexts,
They
though.
certainly are. And please check out this was from the website we shared earlier, I think. Which website is this from? The Cambridge Together website, I think, Rosalia, this one, yeah?
Exactly. Well, you can find all sorts of wonderful things. Remember, write and improve. We mentioned it yesterday, and some people here have been saying that they have started to talk to Sandy. I think Sandy is lovely, right? And you can
Sandy
see
is so
she's a
cute.
baby robot. Lovely, Sandy. Right, go and talk to her or go and use Write and Improve. Remember, this is something that we can do for ourselves, but certainly something that you can do for learners. Oh, look, the baby penguin.
Speaking of cute, yeah, use existing resources, exploit not just your learners but also parents.
Exploit the parents.
Yeah.
Interesting.
No, but use them as a resource. They're a resource that are
Exactly.
there.
Connect with them.
Connect with them, they're there to help. Basically, you could have drop-ins, you could have a live doc with certain questions that you have editing control over, but questions that come in maybe by telephone or by email, and then you kind of put them in and give answers to any queries. Definitely share the plan of work with them, and definitely share those little pulse checks that you're going to give, like those Rosalie was just saying, that like the formative assessment tasks. Students know, but it's important as well that the teachers know, so that they know that there's a constant monitoring going on. It's not a judgment, it's to inform how you're going to adapt the curriculum and materials to best suit their students. And you could even involve them by showing them speak and improve and write and improve. Obviously, parents are going to have varying levels of English, but some of them might enjoy just having a go. And those that are quite good might quite enjoy seeing how just how good they are. So getting them involved in that, I think, will be very positive. Those are two resources, or three, sorry, with Quizzer English. There are more that you could get them involved in.
You could have parents challenging their kids, or kids challenging their parents with Quiz Your English, for example. Why not?
Why not? What an idea. And what about that formative assessment? Obviously, you're going to be doing that maybe with progress tests, with quizzes, definitely looking at shared documents where maybe you've asked them to use certain words or to correct certain texts. Again, no paper, it's light really on admin, and it's you dipping in. It makes total sense to really try to keep that constant monitoring going. If you're going to be doing things in class, you could even get them to self or peer assess. So having a very simple checklist like this, where you're asking, this is for example, grammar or grammar and vocabulary in spoken discourse. You could start training them, especially if they're teenagers. For younger learners, you can definitely do this, but it would need to be very simple, basically, and it'd be more reflective on themselves rather than looking at units of language. But for grammar and vocabulary, there, has your partner used simple grammar? Yes or no? You know, hopefully they're using some constructs that you've been teaching that are not just simple. Have they used difficult grammar like conditionals and past tenses or perfect tenses? Have they used synonyms instead of just repeating the same word? So really instilling and getting them to, maybe you might get them to self-reflect first before they get to peer review. Maybe even get them to do it to you, where you give a very simple answer if it's in writing or speaking, and then you give a very, very kind of sophisticated one, just to get them comfortable with this kind of yes, no, and comments.
I wonder whether we can finish in 1 minute. There are some very worried marketing goblins. I meant
right. Okay.
Elves, sorry, I didn't mean goblins. Goblins tend to be a bit wicked.
Well, you will be. Yeah. You might be doing Christmas webinar, but the Christmas cards won't be arriving for you, Rosalie, if you continue like that. So when you're using Rubric, definitely run it through Text Inspector. If you haven't checked that out before, have a look. It tells you what level of language pretty much the written sample is. And that means you can make it as simple as possible. Even if you've got a B2 group, you don't want to be having complicated rubric because you're already asking them to self and peer evaluate. This would be great for speaking, for example, where they're in a group or whatever, and there's a group leader that has to evaluate that particular week. Make it as simple as possible so that there is the cognitive load isn't so heavy, and what they have to do in processing is really focused primarily on the task rather than the language of actually engaging with the task. This is a final example. This one's for discourse management. Again, you might rephrase that discourse management. These are taken from some colleague slides. This was done a couple of months ago, and I think these are great ideas. I might rename discourse management something else, like organization, just so students are a bit more comfortable with engaging with this. But the same concept, yes or no, and then comments and examples. With the idea of recording as well, which we'll come on to very briefly in a second, it's great for peer assessment. They can just,
for self-assessment.
Yeah, moving on very swiftly. Some of you might have seen this already, the word wall. This is quite good because if you're going to have those peer assessment tables and they're ready for the students to tick or complete online, where are the prompts? Again, this is something you can just release and let them do in breakout rooms. You might have a word wall ready with questions that are related to the topic. You might have created it, or you might be on word wall and say, this will work for my students. You know, personal questions on where they're from and what they do at the weekend or whatever. And then they're there saying yes, no, you know, ticking off. Check this out. It's really cool. This is a Wheel of Fortune type thing. So again, bit of audio, a bit of visual stimulus. So it's not just text or you saying everything. And there are all kinds of different game shows. This is another one where You could even have a dice or something, or have a coin that you're flicking, and the person who gets whatever correct or guesses correctly gets to choose a number, and then they get to ask somebody in the class that question.
Very nice
But
idea.
really cool resources. And finally, a comment on self-recording. I did actually use tapes in the classroom when I started teaching. But look at it now. You can just we've got like is it, there's voice spice recorder that we've got that you can send in an email to somebody, preferably the teacher obviously or whatever. They would send the recording to you. And there's Vocaroo, or I can never remember. I always get that confused, but I've got it saved on my computer. But that ability to record oneself is so much easier these days than it used to be. And so
Oh,
engage with
certainly,
that.
yeah.
And as we mentioned yesterday, have that learning portfolio. Maybe if they're old enough, like mid-teens, even young teens, get them to take some autonomy over keeping their collection, their learning portfolio for the year. And then they hand that in at the end of the year with the tasks that they've done, the recordings that they've done. And then it gives you a really nice sample of their English language for that year, and a very kind of reliable base to judge any grades on. Some considerations. Rosalía, there are lots of things to keep in mind, aren't there, with assessment?
Exactly. Integrated learning and assessment, everything to do with the important things that have happened. Don't forget that you have peers, that you have help, that you have support from different sources that you can do. Lots of different ways to go about it, lots of different things to try. And as we said again and again, I mean, see what works for you, for your context, for your virtual classroom, for your learners, etc. And use that, adopt it, and adapt it.
Exactly.
30 seconds, Jonny. I challenge you.
Well, no, we're leaving this purely as reference. It covers a lot of the things we've been talking about, and really thinking about that digital toolkit that you should have ready to go, basically. So we're not going to talk you through those. These are things that we've seen. And
Vocaroo,
finally,
Rebecca, thank you.
Vocaroo. Yeah, I thought I was right at the first one, then I said Vocaroo, whatever. But yeah. Well, thank you for your time. Apologies for running over. We have somebody saying he wasn't very pleased with that one comment.
What can I
I'm
do?
very
Jonny
sorry.
loves talking. He
And
talks and talks
Rosalina's
all
as well.
the
It's that, or we rush and then the content is not as rich.
No,
So
but
I think 10 minutes over, we do apologize, but at the same time, I think it was worth those extra few minutes. If people have had to disconnect, then they can come on
no.
later.
We totally understand. Just very swift reminders, as I said. Please, you should have received communication, probably an email from your center telling you about a webinar tomorrow. So if you haven't received it today, you'll probably get it later today or early tomorrow, but make sure that you know from your center. All three webinars have been recorded, so you will have the chance to watch them. And remember, you will be getting your certificates. Expect to get those starting next week. And you will be getting all the links and all the list of the different resources, references, etc. Speak and Improve, everything that you heard. And it's been great, great to have you here. We've absolutely had a really very good time. Johnny, I've already started work on that Christmas activities webinar.
Well,
So
fantastic. Let me know about costumes and stuff. But yeah, thank you very much, guys. We will be disconnecting now, or in the next few seconds. Recordings will be shared. Email with links will be on the way. Have a lovely evening. For those that have stayed for the three of them, thank you very much. For those that
thanks to
have missed
everyone
on,
for all their
check on the
comments. I mean,
recordings. Yeah.
very, very kind words. We loved it here, as you can say. That's why I keep on saying we really hope, Johnny, and I hope that this was a good experience for us. For us, it was great to be talking to you, our lovely ELT colleagues, and keep safe.
Have a lovely evening. Take care.